We're now joined by Camarines Sur Representative Gabriel Bordado. Good morning, Congressman. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning. Magandang umaga po sa lahat.
Okay, sir, let's first start with your reaction. How would you describe the recent passage of this measure to actually constitute a constitutional convention to overhaul the Constitution?
To start, we had to deliberate on the resolution of both houses, number 6, yung nagbibigay ng go signal to proceed with the constitutional convention. But I told my colleagues na medyo alanganin ang takbo ng ganitong resolution. Kasi hindi pa tayo nakakalabas sa pandemic. Ano? Nandun pa ang epekto ng pandemic sa atin at nilugmok nito ang ating ekonomiya. And we have to attend to other pressing needs. We have to address them immediately or else we will be in real trouble. And I fully agree with the comments made by the President himself, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Ang sabi niya, the Constitutional Convention is not a priority for me because there are many things that need to be done. There are so many other things that we need to do first. But for me, all these things we are talking about can be achieved without replacing the Constitution, mm-hmm. unquote.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I do hope na hindi pa siya nagbago sa kanyang paninindigan dito. And I quoted him in my manifestation sa pagkontra dun sa RBH number 6.
Okay.
It may be recalled, madam, na marami kasing attempts na talagang amend ang 1987 Philippine Constitution. Kung i-trace natin ito, nagsimula ito nung panahon pa ni former President Fidel Ramos. At pinagpatuloy din ito ni Speaker Jose de Venecia noong 2006. And even during the administration of Pinoy, Benigno S. Aquino III, nagkaroon din ng move to amend the 1987 Philippine Constitution.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's right, sir.
Hanggang sa panahon ni President Rodrigo Duterte. So, ibig sabihin na halos every administration may attempt mm-hmm. to amend the Constitution.
Okay. Sir, before we move on to the thoughts of or the previous pronouncement of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., let's first deep dive into this resolution of both houses number 6. It sets an election for delegates to a constitutional convention on October 30. That's about 7 months from now. What do you make out of this seeming rush to set the CONCON into motion?
Yeah, precisely. I was also questioning that. Bakit isasabay dun sa election ng mga barangay officials at mga SK officials? Ang sabi ko noon, the task of amending the Constitution is a huge undertaking. And an election of the delegates of the Constitutional Convention requires thorough preparation. If the election of delegates will be held simultaneously with the barangay and sangguniang kabataan elections this coming October 2023, we only have around 7 months. Tinanong ko si Representative Rufus Rodriguez, ang chairman ng Committee on Constitutional Amendments sa plenary. Ang sabi ko sa kanya, do we have enough time to prepare the country for this additional responsibility? Eh, ang sabi niya, kaya daw, pero ilang beses nang na-postpone ang SK at barangay elections. Ilang beses nang hindi ito itinuloy. So, with the filing of the candidacies for the CONCON coinciding with the filing of the candidacy for BSKA and SK, may problema tayo dito.
Mm-hmm. And sir, add to that, it's not just 7 months because it's still pending in the Senate. The Senate has not even begun yet, so that will eat a chunk of that 7 months. So it will be shorter than 7 months. But based on your analysis, sir, bakit po may seeming rush? Bakit parang nagmamadali ang colleagues, ang majority sa House of Representatives to actually put this in motion already? Because if they want to do this, they can schedule it next year. Why this year? Why immediately, sir?
Yun nga po ang aking itinatanong sa kanila. Bakit nagmamadali sila? Even the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry, the biggest businessmen in the country, ay nagpahayag na medyo alanganin po ano na madaliin ang amendment of the Constitution na pwede namang gawin sa regular legislation or even executive orders ang mga sinasabi nilang mga restrictive provisions tungkol sa mga business operations dito sa ating bansa. They cited na nakapasa nga sa amin ang Foreign Investment Act, Retail Trade Liberalization Act, Public Service Act, Corporate Recovery and Tax Incentives for Enterprises Act or CREATE. Iyan nga ang hindi ko maintindihan dahil hindi pa tayo nakakalabas sa problema natin sa COVID-19 pandemic.
Sir.
And grabe ang problema natin sa iba-ibang sektor ng ating society with the poverty, the hunger, the health problems, the education problems, human rights problems, runaway inflation. So bakit mag-focus dito sa charter change?
Sir, any perceived motive based on your analysis?
Ayokong mag-judge.
I understand, sir. Okay,
oo.
Sir, clarify ko lang ha. There were several reports mentioning that under the discussions in the House, there seems to be a guarantee na may 10,000 peso daily compensation for each of the 316 members. Is that figure correct?
Yeah. Nandun sa House Bill number... House Bill number 7352.
Okay.
Or itong tinatawag nating Constitutional Convention Act of 2023.
Mm-hmm. And just to break this number for our viewers, just to break down this number for our viewers, 10,000 peso a day. In a week, that's 50,000 pesos a day. In a month, that's 50,000 pesos. And in a month, that's 200,000 pesos for just one member of the 316-member body. So I did the math. If their tenure would be from December 2023 to June 2024, that would cost the taxpayer some 1.4 million pesos per CONCON member. And if you would take into account 316 members, that would be around 442.4 million pesos.
Yes.
How did your colleagues justify this amount? How did they come up with this number?
Ang sinasabi nga nila, according to Representative Rufus Rodriguez, abuti ng billion sa pesos ang gagastusin dito. Mga 9 billion yata ang budget dito. But the National Economic and Development Authority came up with another estimate na pwedeng umabot pa ng mga 20 billion pesos ang magagastos natin dito sa Constitutional Convention. So, bakit natin gagamitin ang ganitong kataas na expenses or funding na ngayon nga ay umuutang tayo? Umuutang tayo. We are trying to get loans para makabuelo ang ating ekonomiya. Kasi as of now, we have a total of more than 13 trillion. More than 13 trillion pesos sa pagkakautang.
Mm-hmm. And sir, how do you describe this hefty price tag, considering that on top of this daily compensation, meron pa silang guaranteed travel and lodging allowance? How would you describe that,
yeah,
sir?
Yeah, yun lang sinasabi ko. Instead of spending this on-con, gamitin natin ito sa mga bagay na talagang nakaka-apekta sa atin ngayon. nakaka-apekta sa mga mamamayang Pilipino. So, I don't know kung ano ang reason nila, kung bakit talagang nakatutok sila rito at ang sabi nila, we have the funding, but as I told you earlier, baon sa utang ngayon ang Pilipinas.
Mm-hmm.
At talagang kinakailangan natin na mag-budget ng maigi upang ma... Well, we can address all these concerns ng ating mga mamamayan.
Hmm.
So, I really am wondering kung bakit masyadong mainit ang aking mga kasamaan na ipasok itong constitutional convention.
Mm-hmm. Earlier, sir, you mentioned that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Pointed out that he's not in favor of having a charter change at this point in time, taking into consideration that the Philippines can still get more investments even without a cha-cha. So despite this measure, why do you think that there is still an overwhelming support for this charter change at this point in time? Where do you think your colleagues are getting the audacity to actually push for this measure despite a very clear pronouncement from the president?
Yeah, my concern is, yun nga, bakit nga, ano? No, during the interpellation part sa plenary, I reminded Representative Rufus Rodriguez, na siyang chairman ng Committee on Constitutional Amendments, na sabi ko kay Rufus, the president himself ay nagsasabi na hindi natin to kailangan. But then he was reminding me too that Congress, the House of Representatives and the Senate, ito ay independent from the office of the president. I agree with him, pero talagang nakakagulat notwithstanding the position taken by the president himself, eh kung bakit talagang napakalakas ang pasok nitong constitutional convention. Imagine 301 members voted for resolution of both houses number 6. Anim lang kaming kumontra. And then pagdating doon sa approval of House Bill 7352 or the Constitutional Convention Act of 2023, ganun pa rin, 301 ang nagboto, 7 na ang kumontra. So nakakapagpaka nga ano, kung bakit sinasabi ni President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. na ayaw niya, but still, ang lakas ng loob ng mga kasamaan ko. Ano, tinatanong ko yung ibang mga kasamaan ko kahapon, pero ang sabi nila, yun daw ang kanilang paninindigan. So I respect them for their positions, pero nakakapagtaka.
Still a puzzle that remains to be solved. Sir, some of your colleagues who also voted against the bill called this measure a deja vu, citing the 1971 Constitutional Convention that led to the passage of the 1973 Constitution that gave the first Marcos president virtually unlimited powers during his term. Do you share the same view? How accurate is this parallelism?
Yes, ganito rin ang aking paninindigan dyan. They are telling us na they will just concentrate on the so-called restrictive economic provisions embedded in the 1987 Constitution. Pero later on, sinabi ni Representative Rufus Rodriguez na once na mag-convene ang Constitutional Convention, we cannot control them, yung mga delegates. Wala nang control. The Congress won't have any controls. CONCON, the office of the president, would have any control. So, may problema na. Ano? Sinasabing they will just focus on the restrictive economic provisions. But then, given the pronouncements made by Representative Rodriguez, the delegates can now proceed to other provisions, particularly the political provisions. And magkakaroon ng problema ang ating bansa sa ganong sistema.
And should we expect oppositors of this bill to actually question this measure before the Supreme Court, assuming that this would hurdle the Senate?
Sa tingin ko, maraming mag-question din ng decision na ganito. Pero we will have to wait for the action of the Senate of the Philippines. Ako'y tutuwa dahil nagpahayag na rin si Senate President Subiri nung isang araw na mahihirapan daw itong makapasa sa Senado dahil they don't have the numbers.
Okay.
So, but we will wait kung ano ang mangyayari sa Senado, because once the bill was approved sa House noong isang araw, there was already an order to transmit this to the Senate para sila naman ang mag-deliberate on the House bill on Constitutional Convention Act of 2023. So, yan ang hihintayin natin kung ano ang mangyayari sa Senado. Although nagpahayag na ang kanilang leader na mahirap makapasa ito sa Senado.
Okay. Sir, and what provisions should senators and the public watch out for, aside, of course, from the hefty compensation package that will be granted to members of the Constitutional Convention?
The open-ended setup na mangyayari dito, sabi nga ng mga tao, ng mga experts, pwede nang ibaguhin ang mga term limits, pwede nang magkaroon ng pagbabago sa system of government natin. Marami nang pwedeng mangyari. Kasi kuha na sila eh. Autonomous entity na ang CONCON, and baka lalong magka-problema tayo sa darating na panahon dahil nga sa gagawin ng mga delegates ng Constitutional Convention. So, ang sa akin lang, sinabi ko dun sa aking manifestation sa 7352, na the call for a constitutional convention which is supposedly anchored on the need to liberalize the restrictive economic provisions embedded in the Philippine Constitution, we could make the Philippines more attractive to foreign investors through regular legislation and executive orders to be issued by the President. And then ang sabi ko dito, ang warning ko, we cannot pin all our hopes on the prospect that foreign investments alone would be the key to escaping our economic rut. Sustainable growth would not be possible if we fail to address the pressing concerns already threatening to overwhelm us. Therefore, ang sa aking conclusion doon, we should first set our sights towards remedying the urgent and continual problems already plaguing the country. Mm. Unemployment rate has been rising steadily since last year. Inflation inched down to 8.6% this February, still an all-time high within a 14-year time frame. Tapos price of goods and commodities continue to shoot up. And the recent transport strike showed how our jeepney drivers struggle to afford the modernization the government insists on implementing.
Okay. Sir, and before we go, what about the provision recommending or stipulating that 20% of the 316-member Constitutional Convention should be appointed? Doesn't that raise a red flag, as it may skew the independence and the neutrality of the proposed body?
Yeah, I agree with you. Although, ang sinasabi nila, lalagay daw doon talaga ng mga experts, yung mga nakakaintindi ng law, nakakaintindi kung paano ang paggawa ng isang constitution. But, yan, tama. Medyo red flag ito, na baka ang ipasok dyan will serve the interests nung mga nag-appoint.
Mm-hmm.
Yun ang nakakatakot doon. But we are still hoping against hope na hindi ito gagawin. Pero sa takbo ng mga pangyayari ng mga noong nakaraang dekada pa sa ating kasaysayan, nakita natin na nagkakaproblema.
Mm-hmm. All right, and we will have to end it on that note for now. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, for making time for us, Camarines Sur Representative Gabriel Bordado.
Thank you very much. Maraming salamat din po.